Father, I come broken. We yes. come broken before you, Father. We pray right now, God. Presence, Father, we'll come into this place this evening, God.
Yes.
That, Father, you will meet us in this place, God.
Hallelujah.
As we pour out our worship, Father God.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Father, our thanks. Our love, God. I know it's not enough, Father God. We couldn't do anything that would be enough, Father, but this is all you've asked, God, is just worship. Your creation, your children worshiping you, Father God.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
So, Lord, again, we come broken before you, God.
Yes.
With open arms, open eyes, open hearts, God. We just ask, Father, that you would accept us, that this would be a sweet aroma to you, Father God, that this would be a sweet smell to you, Father God, a sweet sound in your ear, God, that as we worship, it wouldn't be like brass and cymbals clashing together, God, but it would be beautiful to you, God.
Yes.
So maybe we have sang these songs before, Father, but it would be a new song from a new place, Father God. Lord, I pray that you're anointing, God, will be upon the worship team right now as they lead us to you, Father God, and to your presence, God, as they call on you, God. We follow them, Father, as they follow you in song. Lord, we just pray that your presence, God, would fill this place, God.
Yes, Lord.
The Bible says that all they sang was holy, 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 and smoke would fill the temple, God. Come to you, Father, from a personal place, God, as we sing these songs in worship, expecting, God, you to fill this place, God. We want nothing less than you, God.
Yes, Lord.
Father, I pray that every heart here, God, will truly worship you in spirit and in truth,
yes,
Father, God.
Yes.
Lord, we just pray for this,
hallelujah,
this worship service, God, and we just pray, God, and we give this all to you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you.
Christ is risen from the grave. recognize the cross, we will always have a reason to worship. God, worship can be our only response, Lord.
But the blood. God, that would make us more like you, God. We don't ever want to gather in your presence and leave the same way.
Hallelujah.
And so we give you free reign, Holy Spirit. Do what you want to do. Speak through your pastor to minister, God, what you want to say to us tonight. That you would give him the words to speak. That you would allow him to come with conviction and power and authority, God. That, Lord, we wouldn't see Pastor Nick, but we would see you.
Yes, Lord.
The voice within the voice, God.
Yes,
hallelujah.
So we look forward to what you want to do tonight, God. But again, most of all, we want you to be glorified in the house.
Yes, hallelujah.
You get all the glory. You get all the honor. You get all the worship, God. The word of it all. Precious name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen, church. Amen. God is so good. Turn around and welcome one another in the house of the Lord.
Sorry.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Hallelujah. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, right? And filling this house up. So just first off, welcome everybody, amen. Can we get Passion Week ready to just seek the Lord? And I believe that, you know, as we pursue Him this week, that He's going to continue to show up. And the more that we chase after His heart, the more clearly we'll begin to hear Him. Amen.
Amen.
So I'm excited for what God wants to do. I just want to go over a couple announcements. Just a lot of things going on right now. This week alone, we have a lot of different things. So first off, tonight, obviously, we're here. Tomorrow night, we're here. And then Friday night, we're going to be at the Pittsburgh campus. Amen. Because as you can see, we're getting a little tight in here. Amen. And so for those of you that are comfortable, you know, because you hang out outside of church and you're comfortable without a gap between you, feel free to, you know, scoot one seat over. Amen. We want to make sure that as people still continue to come here from work and whatnot, that they have a place to sit. Amen. So again, we're going to be here again tomorrow night. And then we'll be at the Pittsburgh campus on Friday night, amen? And Pastor Ralph is going to be ministering Friday night. So I really want to encourage you. It's one of the few times that we're going to be able to have him minister again. Lord willing, if they go to Spain in the time frame that they're hoping to. And so just, you don't want to miss out on the opportunity. And so, again, that'll be Friday night. And then a couple other things going on. We still have the sign-up sheet for Sunday for anybody that wanted to sign up still. For the barbecue that we're going to do after both of the services are over. The sign-up sheet's on this little table in the foyer. And so I know a lot of people have signed up. Thank you, amen. I want to just believe and trust the Lord that we're going to have a ton of visitors. We're going to see people get saved. We're going to see people get delivered, amen. And after that happens, we want to get together and celebrate and fellowship with them, amen. And so we're also going to be stuffing over 2,000 eggs, amen. And so, if any of you are available, Friday morning, my wife's going to come down here around 10 and start stuffing eggs, amen. And so, we want to bless the kids. We just want to have a good time in the Lord. For those of you that don't know where the park is on that Sunday, we'll be highlighting it for everyone. But it is on Buchanan Road, between Somersville and Loveridge. It's like a block up from the DMV. And so everybody knows where DMV is, unfortunately. Amen. And so it's Highlands Ranch Park. And so I want to encourage you, come out. Let's celebrate. Let's have a good time with the Lord. Amen. Also, just another thing that's going on is in 2 weeks from today, April 14th, we're going to start the next Bible school class here. And that class is going to be focused on Undercover and Made of Satan. And so if you have not done those courses, or if you're trying to do the whole school and you've not done it in the school, I want to encourage you, sign up. It's on Wednesday nights here at 6:30, amen. We gather together for worship, and then the class also starts around 7. If you are intending to sign up, please see Pastor Jennifer. Again, we need to order books. We already ordered some of the workbooks, but if you need, for example, the Undercover book or what, you guys get those. I teach the class, so I'll be here on those Wednesdays with you. But I want to encourage you, if you're wanting to get involved in ministry, if you're wanting to know where to really start off, maybe you did the two-week class, maybe you've done you know, the what's next, but this is honestly, this is the thing that I would encourage you to do afterwards. Undercover and Bait of Satan are two very important subjects that John Bevere dives into, that without them I wouldn't be a pastor today. I wouldn't be here. Pastor Ralph says that in regards to Undercover, outside of the Bible, that is the most important book to him becoming a pastor. And so I encourage you, if you have any questions, please come and talk to me. Talk to Pastor Jennifer. Amen?
Amen.
And I think that is all of them. Praise the Lord. And so we're going to go ahead and take up an offering, and they're going to show a little video for that. Amen? Amen. I know that's not any of us, right? Praise the Lord. You know, it's good to laugh at things like that and enjoy things in the house of God, but, you know, it also should be kind of a gut check. How big of the pie do we even put on the Lord's plate in comparison to all these other things we gladly pay for ahead of time? Amen. And so I know that you guys are faithful, and like I said, that's nobody in here, but we always want to challenge one another. Amen. And so, as always, make sure that you're praying over your seed. And when you're ready, you can bring it up at this time.
Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for what was given today, Father God. Continue to use it to build your kingdom, Father God. We need to be kingdom-minded, Father. And we thank you for everything you've given us, Father, because it's all yours. It all belongs to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So tonight, we have the honor of having our crazy San Francisco pastor out here with us. Amen. So let's welcome our pastor again.
Jesus, your entry into Jerusalem, Father, that you would just give us your heart, God, that you would just allow this to be a great start for the rest of this week, Father, to learn about even more the Last Supper, the crucifixion, and the resurrection, God. We just give this night in your hands, God. We know that through you, God, we can do all things, God, but without you, we can do nothing, Father. So we just give you this time, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm used to the huge screen in Pittsburgh, so I wasn't too much. All right, so yeah, today I'm talking about Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, which is the intro for the crucifixion, or Lord's Supper, crucifixion, resurrection, right? So I'm going to start, and I'm just going to start with Luke 19. I'm going to start by reading it. So he has verse 29. So Jesus, background. A third of the book of Mark is like the last week, basically, of his life, right? And it starts with this, usually is Palm Sunday, right? I don't know if you guys might have preached about this last Sunday, actually. But the last week of his life is the most important, right? So most religions, most whatever philosophies, they don't usually focus on the death of the person that it's based around. It's usually focused on the life of the person. Christianity is a lot different because it's focused on the death of the central person, who is Jesus. And so this is the beginning of the last week of his life. This is Luke 19, and I'm going to read 28 through 44. It says, when he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And as it came to pass, when he drew near to Bethpage and Bethany at the mountain called Olivet, that he sent two of his disciples, saying, go into the village opposite you, where as you enter you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, why are you loosing it? Thus you shall say to him, because the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent went their way and found it just as he had said to them. But as they were loosing the colt, the owners of it said to them, why are you loosing the colt? And they said, the Lord has need of him. Then they brought him to Jesus, and they threw their own clothes on the colt, and they set Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. Let's start right here for a second. So yeah, in Matthew it says that a large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road as well. So just going into this, so Jesus is fulfilling a prophecy. It's in Zechariah 9. I don't know if you actually have it up there too, but he's fulfilling a prophecy. Zechariah 9:9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. So Jesus is fulfilling a prophecy, and everybody expected the Messiah to come like this. I've heard people say that, you know, if a king was at peace, he'd ride a donkey. If he was at war, he'd ride a stallion. I don't think that's true historically. I don't think a king would ever usually ride actually on a donkey. This was a beast of burden, mostly just used for work. I think it's kind of funny because it'd be like Jesus like walking up to you and just hopping in your truck that you use for work and be like, hey, I need this. Because he just kind of just takes it, right? He had a word of knowledge. He knew that the donkey was going to be there. There was a common practice with kings where if the king owned any type of animal, nobody was allowed to sit on it except for him. So the donkey, the horse, whatever, it's important that Jesus said, you know, get the one that no one's ever ridden on, right? And the other thing that's kind of interesting about that means that nobody would have ever broken that donkey to ever ride it. And the fact that it was even calm enough to take him and not go crazy is also interesting. He's actually, even in this, signifying that he is actually the king of the Jews. Because he's saying he wants a donkey or, you know, a colt that no one's ever sat on. And they basically make a saddle for him out of it, out of their own clothes. And when they're throwing their clothes down on the path, it is a triumphal entry, right? And the palm branches, the palm usually means victory, right? It has a couple different meanings. And the palm branch in the ancient Near East symbolized victory, triumph, peace, and eternal life, actually. So I'm going to keep reading. Then he was now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives. The whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all of the mighty works they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And when the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." But he answered and said to them, "I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out." Now as he drew near, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, "If you had known, even you, Jerusalem, especially in this your day, the things that make for your peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. For days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surround you, and close you in on every side, and level you and your children within you to the ground. And they will not leave in you one stone upon another, because you did not know the time of your visitation." So, he's coming, right? And he's fulfilling this prophecy. And all of these people are saying, "Hosanna in the highest. Blessed be the name of the Lord," right? And the Pharisees, the religious leaders at the time, are mad. Because they know this is a prophecy, right? About the Lord, about the Messiah. And they're saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord," saying he's the Christ. "Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And the Pharisees in the crowd, they said, "Rebuke your disciples." And he said, "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." I'm going to read a little bit from some of the, basically just give an overview of some of the other Gospels, because they all work together, right? Sometimes when you see, you know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they'll be a little bit different, but it's because it's four different people, well, three different people's perspective, and Luke actually went around asking people what they saw, so it was an eyewitness account of possibly hundreds of people, if not more, from around the area. And so sometimes when you read all four, rather than be like, "Oh, how come he saw this and he saw that?" It's because they're focusing on a specific part of it, but it all works together. It's the same thing. So John 12, starting verse 16, it says, "At first his disciples did not understand all of this, but only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that these things had been done to him. Now the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to spread the word. Many people, because they had heard that he had performed the sign of resurrection, went out to meet him. So the Pharisees said to one another, 'See, this is getting us nowhere. Look how the whole world has gone after him.'" So, and in Matthew, it actually brings up these prophecies. It brings up, you know, this is was written to fulfill the prophecy in Zechariah, and there's another one from Psalms that he fulfilled. "Say to your daughter Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So I wanted to go into this. So they said, you know, rebuke them, right? They're saying, "Blessed is the King who's coming." And they're saying, these religious leaders are saying, rebuke them because they believe that they're blasphemy. They're saying you're the Messiah, rebuke them. And he says, "If they don't worship me, then the rocks will cry out." So this is interesting that out of all of creation, right, everything knows what to do, right? Birds didn't have anybody to teach them to make a nest. You know, foxes, right? This is, you know, foxes have holes. Nobody taught them that. Nobody taught bears to hibernate. They all do these things. The Bible talks about how all creation, you know, when it functions the way that it is worshiping the Lord. But people are the only thing that have a choice, it seems like, to not worship the Lord by not acting in the way that God created them to act. So out of all these things, right, Jesus is saying that, okay, if they didn't worship me, all of creation would know to worship me. Because creation is not deceived. The birds, the rocks, the trees, everybody knows who the Lord is, but you don't know who the Lord is. And he's giving him a lesson, right? And it's convicting because when we have this choice, right, God gave Adam and Eve free will. He gave mankind free will. We have the choice to choose God. We have the choice to do whatever we want to do. But there's a judgment for whatever we do, whether it's good or whether it's evil. And we'll actually see that there's a lot of different reactions to Jesus as he enters into Jerusalem. In Mark, after, again, how the Gospels, they have different details, it says he actually went to the temple directly after entering into Jerusalem like this. He went to the temple, it says he looked around, and because it was late, he went back to Bethany. So, there are so many different ways that people responded to him, right? And I'm going to even go into when he sees Jerusalem. So, I'm going to finish reading the last part of that, actually, where he's weeping over Jerusalem in Luke, if you can put those last verses up. And I can read it on here, too. As he approached, okay, no, not that one, it's 41, so it says, right after the stones were cried, it says, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it, and said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment upon you and encircle you, and hem you in on every side. Oh, we did read this, right? They will dash you to the ground, you and your children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God is coming to you. So the Bible says that he is the visible image of the invisible God. So even though he's giving people a choice, right? He's showing himself to everybody. This is the visitation that he's talking about. The glory of God departed from Israel it's about 586 years B.C. If you read, I didn't put it in the slides, but in Ezekiel chapter 10, the Bible actually says that the glory departed from the temple. That there was hundreds of years where they were not hearing from God. There was a huge gap between the Old Testament and when Jesus comes on the scene, where God did not speak. When we talk about the Ark of the Covenant and the presence of God that was on that, that didn't exist in the temple at the time of Jesus Christ coming. That existed in the Old Testament, that existed with the Levitical priests, and that was where, you know, the presence of God would be when they would give the sacrifices, the mercy seat, and they would sacrifice the animal to be able to get mercy for their own sins and then the sins of their people. But when Jesus came, that didn't exist anymore. And when he says this is God's heart, is that he's weeping over them. It says he looked over Jerusalem, and he wept. And he knows, because he knows that the judgment of God is going to come upon them for not turning to the Lord. And again, all of creation knows what to do but us. And he's giving them a chance to worship, right? Amen. So as we go through this, if you would read, you're gonna see through this for the next few days. I'm gonna go through this right real quick. There were a lot of fans that Jesus had. I don't know how many people, thousands of people were there when he entered into Jerusalem, but it was probably a lot. And they all waved palm branches, and they were fans of Jesus, right? They weren't followers of Jesus necessarily, because a lot of these people turned their back on him when he was crucified. And we'll see that there's so many different things, and even his disciples did, right? Herod, Pilate, they all had a different reaction. But the thing that's important to remember is that Jesus, you want to go to the Luke 9:51 scripture, it says, it came to pass when the time had come that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. So even though, you know, and this is true for our lives, the way to apply this is that if we have something that God's told us, it doesn't matter how many people cheer you on at the beginning and then backstab you later, which is what they all do to him. It doesn't matter how many people are against you. It says that he set his face steadfastly towards Jerusalem. He didn't get pumped up because people waved him in. And he didn't get discouraged later because they betrayed him. The whole thing about Jesus is that he had a purpose, right? He didn't just go to Jerusalem to fulfill that verse in Zechariah. He went there for a purpose. And it was to die on the cross, right, for our sins, and that he would be raised up. And that was his focus. He wasn't focused on the way that people acted. He wasn't focused on the way that they treated him. Because later, on the cross, they mocked him, and it's in I think it's Matthew 27, 29. They say, they mock him. He comes in, at first like a king, and they honor him. Later, the same people mock him, and they after they twisted a crown of thorns on his head, you know, these are the Roman soldiers, but they bowed before him, mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." Later, it says in the plaque mounted, right, "Hail, King of the Jews." When they mocked him, they said, "He saved others and he can't save himself. If he is the King of Israel," this is the Pharisees, "let him come down from the cross now and we will believe in him." In 27:42. They mocked him, right? It didn't matter. He didn't focus on what they said or what they saw. It says in John 2:19-25, "But Jesus did not commit himself to man, because he knew all men, and had no need that anybody should testify of man, for he knew what was in man." In Romans 3:3-4 says, "For what if some did not believe? Will their unbelief make the faithfulness of God without effect?" This is concerning Israel, promises to them. "Certainly not. Indeed, let God be true, but every man a liar, as it is written, that you may be justified in your words and may overcome when you are judged." Okay, so he wasn't, and we can get lost in this, right? Sometimes you can be encouraged when people are encouraging, or discouraged when people are discouraging. But Jesus didn't, it says he didn't even care. They already tried to make him king. He didn't pay attention to them. It says, because he knew what was in men. And it's not good. That's not a good verse, right? He says he didn't entrust himself to men because he knew what was in men. That's saying that there's not good things in men. And he didn't let what they were going to do. He knew that they were going to betray him, right? He knew that Judas was going to betray him, and he still washed his feet. He knew that those people that were saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," were going to mock him later and mock him and say, "Oh, if he's the king, let him come down." And it didn't sway Jesus from his goal, which was the cross, and which we're going to see eventually, because it says, "For the hope set before him, you know, he despised the shame," because he knew that he was going to be raised up and bring life to men. Amen. So we see that there were many fans, and there's a lot of people, and you might have been a fan, where Jesus is cool, right? Jesus is a good teacher, Jesus is a nice guy, and it's just about the victory for us, right? And that's the problem with most Christianity, is that it's like a bless me gospel, right? Jesus is coming because he's going to bring victory in my life in all situations. And he does bless us, right? God does give us victory over sin, over temptation. He does give us victory in a lot of things, right? We overcome death through Christ. But is that why Jesus came? Did he come so they would personally believe, be blessed, so that they would have victory over the Romans? Because that's what they thought. No. They thought Jesus was going to come as a conqueror to defeat the Romans. And he didn't come the way that they wanted, right? And they were mad about it, a lot of people. And so when we think about Christ, do we welcome him, victory, victory? But if he doesn't give us the victory that we're looking for, do we stop following him? Do we start mocking God in the same way and say, "Well, he didn't even come to bring me victory"? Because did Jesus come just for us? And he came to save us, but the Bible says that our goal as Christians is to be conformed to the image of Christ. And when we come to God just for what he can give us, you know, that's how we get such a bad rap sometimes as Christian from televangelists on TBN that want the jumbo jets and the Rolls Royces, because it's just about what God can do for me. And I've heard Pastor Scott and Pastor Ralph talk about this a lot. It's not just about what God can do for me, right? It's about why do we even want Christ to die for us? And it's, the Bible says in Romans 5 that it's to bring us back into a right relationship with God, right? And that he would give us life, and then he would die for our sins. But it's supposed to be a relationship with God, that we'd be imitators of him, and that we could be the light of the world. None of those people, most likely, that were, you know, waving him in, 99% of them were not thinking, "Wow, he's going to make me a better person." You know what I mean? God, he's really going to help me love my enemies. You know, they thought that Jesus came to do something for them, to get rid of the enemies in their life, to get rid of their problems, to get rid of all of the issues that they had, all the frustrations they had. And we can do the same thing. We think that God's going to take us at our job. He's going to get rid of the person that bothers us. He's going to get rid of the people that annoy us at school. But the thing is that that's not his goal. His goal is to put heaven in you so that you can be a light, so that the person that bothers you can be changed. Amen? He's called you to be the change, to be the salt of the earth and the light of the world, not to have a basket over you and to ask God to change the other person, but that God can change you and give you patience and love so that you can be the light to bring change to that person so that you can point them to Jesus. Because that's what we're made for. Amen. So there's also, so we have the fans, and then we also have witnesses, right? There's a lot of people that saw him. There's a lot of people that, you know, are going to end up testifying against him, that are going to be yelling out, crucify him. So how do we act? Are we like Pilate, who believed there was something about Jesus and knew that he was, I believe that he believed that he was the Son of God, right? His wife had a prophetic dream about him. He was afraid to crucify. He was kind of afraid to put him through any of that, right? He tried to let him go, but his career, his ambitions, everything was in the way, right? He was afraid. He was afraid he could have either been put in jail, killed, or put on the front line somewhere else. So it's the same thing. Like, do we have the same mentality like Pilate, where are we not willing to give up, you know, our job or the comforts of our position or what we are already doing or the things? Because following Jesus can be too hard. Or is it like Herod, right? Herod was a hedonist. He was just all about pleasure. He followed hedonism. If you ever saw the movie Passion of the Christ, has him like, you know, hanging out on a couch and stuff. But that's true. I mean, he was like that. And he asked for a miracle, right? He asked Jesus to show him something and to basically perform a miracle like it was like a magic trick almost. And then when he didn't do it, he mocked it, right? And that's the same thing. Do we do the same thing where we just live for our own pleasure and that we want God to do a miracle for us, and when he doesn't do it, we just go back to doing our own thing, living for our own pleasures and be like, oh, God doesn't care anyway. Then we also have the Jews, right? The religious leaders. They persecuted him because he was messing up, and this goes back to why he went to the temple at the end of that section in Mark 11, because their whole thing was regulating the temple. But like I already said, in Ezekiel 10, the glory of the Lord already departed from the temple. So they have, now this, when Jesus came and he read from the scroll in Isaiah, or actually when he was born and he was dedicated, at the temple, that was the first time like the actual manifest presence of God had probably been in the temple since 586 BC, was when Jesus entered in. And when he taught, that was the first time the word of the Lord had been probably spoken by the Lord for hundreds of years in that temple. So these religious leaders were guarding their religious traditions so much that when, instead of welcoming the Lord in as the king that he is, into their city, into the temple, they persecuted him because they were so content with their religious traditions that they were willing to fight God over their traditions. And this is one of the main things that Jesus actually rebuked them for, even while he was teaching through all the times that he was walking around, right? He rebuked the Pharisees for their hypocrisy. He said, you put heavy loads on people, and by your tradition, you cause people to disobey God by obeying your commandments. He said, if you know, that they were teaching people, oh, if you dedicated money as korban, which is an offering to the temple, that they can never back down on it, even if their family was in need. And by causing them to go by their tradition that you created, they would dishonor their parents, right? And so, what sometimes we think about, you know, the Jews in the temple and the religious leaders, they're seeing the actual temple of God, right? John 1 says, the Word in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then verse 14 says, and the Word became flesh, and he tabernacled among us. And the tabernacle was the original thing before the actual physical temple, right? In the desert, the tabernacle with Moses. So the actual temple of God, the actual tabernacle, was Jesus Christ's flesh. He was fully God and fully man. And the actual, when Jesus told the Pharisees, if you tear this temple down, in 3 days I'll raise it back up. And it said, and they mocked him, and they said how long it took to build it. But it says, not talking about that temple, but his own body. Because he is the temple, and he was filled with the fullness of God. And they were so busy trying to guard the religious traditions and the physical temple that didn't even have the glory of God in it anymore, that they were actually neglecting the real temple that actually had the glory of God in it, who is Christ. So when we come to the place, even on Friday, you guys will see, when Jesus is crucified, there's so many... Actually, I'm going to go... So we always focus on the fact that the veil, right, between the holy place and the most holy place was torn. In the temple, there was the outer court, there was an inner court, there was a holy place, and then there was a huge curtain, and it was the most holy place, and that's where the high priest would do the sacrifice once a year. And we always focus on the fact that the curtain was torn from the top to the bottom. It explicitly mentions that in the Bible, and that there was no more division between the holy place and the most holy place. But that was only... Like, that was in the temple, and the glory wasn't even in there anymore. The actual temple, right, the thing that was really broken and torn was when Jesus was scourged and put on the cross. That was actually his flesh. It actually says in Hebrews that his flesh is like the tabernacle for us. So when he was broken, that was like the real curtain that was torn to bring the glory of God to us, was Jesus Christ, flesh. And the Holy Spirit now being able to be poured out to us because he resurrected. So when we think about the temple, he was the true tabernacle with the true presence of God. And the veil was torn, and it does symbolize what God did, breaking the division. But the veil that was torn that actually had the presence of God in it was the veil of his flesh. And out of all the people that were there, right? There were the religious leaders, the political leaders, the Gentile leaders, the disciples. The only people who actually stayed with him from the beginning of this week to welcome him in, right, was John and a few of the women. Everybody else left, right? Everybody else was saying, oh yeah, you're the king, come, bring victory, or save now, Hosanna means save now. But there was only a few that actually believed that enough to stick with it until the end. So we should be like John, right? He was there. He knew who was going to betray Jesus. He knew who Jesus was, and he didn't betray him. When he said, save now, he stayed with him, right? He didn't have any of the reactions that any of the other people had.
I'm going to read one more verse too.
So when we see that when Jesus was weeping over Jerusalem, that's God's heart for us all the time, right? Because he longs for us, he desires a relationship for us, and it's not just for him to come and sit for us to say, oh yeah, get rid of these problems in my life. But it's for him to transform us too, right? And when he's weeping over us, right, he's desiring, like it says, the Apostle Peter wrote, that God's not slow in keeping his promises, as some count slowness, but he desires that all men would come to repentance and be saved. So when he weeps over Jerusalem, even if he knows that person most likely won't turn to him, he still has a heart that's broken over them. He still has a desire to save. Did anybody do anything right for Christ to come? No, right? Romans 5. And this was what I was going to read, but I didn't put it in there either. Romans 5, starting in verse 8, right? We all know this from like the Romans Road, if you guys know that. That it says that even while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. And when we think about what Jesus went through, It was for people that didn't want it, right? We can be like, oh, John was great, you know what I mean? And the Pharisees were evil. But most of us have probably been like some of those people, like Pontius Pilate, like Herod, seeking our own pleasure, or any of the people there. But thankfully, he didn't come to people who were doing everything right when he decided to come. Romans 5, it says in verse 6, while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would even dare to die. But God shows his love for us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. Much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. Amen. Amen. A lot of the disciples didn't even realize that this is why he came. When we read in John's book, it says they didn't even realize this is why that any of these things were being fulfilled until after he was already glorified, after he resurrected, and after he was already ascended to heaven. When we get justified by Christ, talking about that curtain that was torn, that means that when God looks at you when you pray, like in 1 John it says that if we walk in the light as he is in the light, then the blood of Jesus his son continually cleanses us from all sin and cleanses us from all unrighteousness, and we have fellowship with one another. That means that when Jesus looks at you because of what he did, that even if you weren't like any of those people, you know, maybe welcoming him in but then turning your back on him, that if you repent and turn to him, that he looks at you, to be justified means that he looks at you and he can't think of anything as a mark or a strike against you, as in your personality and what you've done. It's like if you were talking to somebody and you can think in the back of your mind, oh, but they did this, or but they did that, or they talked to me crazy, or they still didn't do this. To be justified, to be completely right with God, righteous means that when God looks at you while you're walking in the light, right? When God looks at you, he's not thinking, oh, but this or that. He's looking at you and he sees you perfectly as somebody who's never done anything that he can hold anything against you. Hallelujah. Because if you're justified in someone's sight, it means to be declared innocent. So just like if you have like a toddler or a baby and you look at the baby and you say, well, this kid's innocent. That's how God literally sees us, because when he died, it says that he separated our sins as far as the east is from the west, which is eternally. And when he looks at you, it means you're innocent. And that when he sees you, when you pray, he's not thinking, oh, but he sinned in his mind, or but oh, but this, or but that, or you know this. He sees you as like, wow, I have nothing against you. There's nothing against your personality, your character, your thoughts that I have against you, and I'm perfectly content with you right now. What do you want? Like, talk to me. And that's how God sees us, because of this week, right? This whole Passion Week. And this is why we're here, right? And we should actually, I guess, like John, welcome Jesus in as the King into our lives, into our hearts, into our, you know, our whole world. And like John, stick with it, even if he's not taking down all the enemies or all the people we have problems with, even if, you know, he doesn't do the miraculous when we ask him to at that time, like Herod, even if, you know, we're afraid of losing our career or our job, we should still welcome him as the King. And even like John, even when it gets hard, when it comes to the cross, which is what we're called to, amen, we should still stick with it. Because Jesus himself said, if anybody desire to come after me, let him deny himself daily, take up his cross, and follow after me.
Amen. Amen.
And we should take that same stance, that we welcome him in as the King, but we're still with him even at the cross, right? And even amen, the cross in our own lives, whatever he would ask us to do. Amen. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, God. Yeah, even if anybody's here and they haven't ever even maybe repented or given their life to you or even received you as that King or counted the cost, God, even that they would right now, we pray, God, to accept everything that you have, good and bad, God, or good and hard, because it all works together for good, God, eternally for us that love you and are called according to your purposes. God, we just ask, God, for more of you, God, and that we would be followers of you, Jesus, that we'd be faithful like John, and even as the Apostle John wrote, the one who Jesus loved, and he saw himself like that, God, as justified, as loved, God, that we would even see ourselves loved by you and realize that you're the only one who has eternal life abiding in you. So we just welcome you here, even in our own lives, fresh today as King, God, and we ask that you would just have your reign and keep us in the good times and the hard times. In Jesus' name, amen.
I love having Pastor Nick because it just, it's just a fresh word, a different perspective, amen. But, you know, I would really say, take to heart, the thing that really was standing out to me, especially as it was closing, was it's real easy to hoot and holler and be excited about Jesus when everyone else is. Right? When it's easy to do it because there's no pushback. There's no confrontation. But really where we have to look at ourselves and say, okay, but what happens when it threatens my dreams, my career, my plans? What happens when Jesus doesn't do what I wanted him to do? Because he's not a genie in a lamp or a vending machine. You just push this and get what you want. You know, what happens when he didn't meet your expectations and he didn't do what you thought he should have done? Sometimes we think God should do things as if we know better than God. When those things come up, when those challenges come, I even consider this week, you know, a lot of people have committed, you guys are here tonight, and you know, I know a lot of you will strive to be at every service, but what about when it's hard? Because see, one thing that I've learned is when we allow something to get in the way, and I'm not saying this in a condemning way, I'm not saying this in a way that you have to be at everything all the time, I'm not saying that. However, we know that there are times that we don't make the things of God a priority because we've made something else a bigger priority. And so my question is, when those things even come up this week, is he still the priority? Will you still stick by him? Will you still pick up your cross daily and follow him? See, we all like the idea of picking up that cross one time to get salvation. But he said to follow, pick it up daily and follow him. And so I challenge you this week because I'm convinced that if you push through and chase after the heart of God this week, that this can be a season of breakthrough. That you can look back at this Resurrection Sunday, this week. I mean, we missed it all last year, right? We didn't even have Passion Week last year. Yeah. We did it online.
Yeah.
But now we're here, and if we press in and we chase after God, not to go through the motions, but to seek his voice.
Amen. Amen.
That God's going to show up.
Hallelujah.
As we were saying earlier, right? His blood doesn't fail. The sacrifice of Christ doesn't fail. And so will we do our part? And I'm convinced that tonight is only the beginning. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Nick. That was awesome, bro. Amen. Tonight, you know, he was praying, and I want to do one thing. I just want this seed to be planted, and as you meditate on the word tonight, what God spoke and what he's going to continue to be speaking, where are you right now? Where are you with the Lord? Are you good? I'm around a lot of you regularly. And I may know you very well, but I still can't know your heart.
Right.
Are you good with God? If we don't even make it to service tomorrow, and he comes back, are you going or are you staying? Are you going to be left behind? It's something we really have to think about. The Lord's really been dealing with my heart that he may tarry. It looks like that he should be here tomorrow, the way things are going. But he may not be here for hundreds of years, so we don't know. And so we have to prepare and set a foundation for future generations. But have the same expectation he can come tomorrow. And we have to live within that. And so are you good with the Lord today? If you're not, you got to get right with him tonight. Because God wants to do something in this way. If you harden your heart and you allow things to be dealt with, you refuse to humble yourself, you'll miss out on what God wants to do in your life. If anything you've seen recently, we can't keep doing the same thing. Things are changing. And that doesn't mean that it has to change us, but we should be sold out for the kingdom of God. We should be sold out for souls, for salvation. Like he said, don't be the light that puts a basket on top of it and hope God works everything else out. Don't do that. So right now, just wherever you're at, if you got to deal with something with the Lord, deal with it. If you know you've been giving place to sin, and I'm not talking about we all make mistakes, but you know that there's areas of your life you have refused to repent. Deal with it. If you've walked away from the Lord, come and talk to me after service if you're ready to get right. If you're not saved, you're not born again, you haven't accepted him as your Lord and Savior, I want you to come up to me and talk to me after service. I want to talk to you. I want to pray with you. Because today is the day of salvation. And the Lord is married to the backslider. There's a whole book dedicated to God redeeming his bride who literally cheated on him. So the whole book is based on. So maybe you've given place to some things. You don't have to stay there. So Father God, I pray, Lord, that you would allow this word that you gave your servant to give to us, God. That it would be a word planted within our hearts, God. That it would take root and that it would bear much fruit. Lord, that we wouldn't just be spectators, we wouldn't just be witnesses, we wouldn't just be fans, God, Lord, but we would be all in, God, that we would be more like John in regards to you than those who ran, or those who yelled crucify him, or those who just denied you. I pray, Lord, that we would be a light in a dark place. And for those, God, who have given place to sin, Lord, I pray right now, convict their hearts. Give them the strength to repent, to turn away, to be delivered from their sin. That they would get back into right relationship with you, God, because you never left. You haven't gone anywhere. You're right there, Lord. And I pray that not only the people in this room, God, but throughout this week, we would see people drawn back to your house. We would see a people drawn back to your presence. That we would see a people drawn back to the body of Christ, Lord. That people would get saved. That people would repent. That people, Lord God, the backslider would return home, God.
Yes, Lord. Yes. Hallelujah.
But Lord, they have to be drawn in by your Spirit. We can't do this in the flesh. Yes. Nor do we want to try, God. Draw them in by your Spirit. Yes. So Lord, we thank you for what you have started tonight. We look forward to what you have going forward, God. We just want to hear your voice and be in your presence. Thank you. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, you guys. We love you guys. Again, we'll be back here tomorrow. Service will start at 7. Amen. Obviously, come and get your seats. Praise the Lord. If you did want to get with Pastor Jennifer about the Equipping the Saints school or sign up for the barbecue stuff, you can go right to the foyer and do that as well.
Other than that, don't forget your kids. Amen? All right, love you guys.
It's not a sleepover. No sleepover.